I'm Mary Parker, and welcome to A Dose of Science. This year, for the Society for Neuroscience annual meeting, we decided to look to the future. We took as our basis a timeline created by SFN for their 50th anniversary and invited experts in their fields to comment on the milestones projected on the timeline. For this milestone, we are discussing brain imaging at its highest resolution of structural and functional level, which SFN predicts will become normal practice in 20 years. To speak to this topic, welcome Dr. Artem Shatillo, head of imaging at Charles River's discovery site in Kuopio, Finland. He has 10 plus years of experience in preclinical CNS imaging and has been working for Charles River for 6 years, running an in vivo imaging facility specialized in preclinical imaging studies for in vivo pharmacology and drug discovery projects. Welcome, Artem.
Hello, and thank you for the introduction.
So, based on what we can do with animal imaging, what do you project for human imaging improvements in the future? Is the translational gap closing?
Yes, technology is accelerating extremely fast. And of course, now is a good time to look into the future based on what we can see coming in the preclinical world. Because obviously, when it comes to animal imaging or any new technology coming to the human market or human research, they have always been first tested in the preclinical setting in animals, because obviously there are certain benefits of doing that before going to clinics.
Yeah, that makes total sense. Would you say that it's more about the availability of animals, or is it just better to work in a simpler organism first before moving up into a more advanced one?
Definitely, it's much easier from the regulations perspective. It's much easier technically, of course. And then again, the sort of availability of tools and additional measurements that we can take is much higher in animals compared to humans. And coming back to your first question about the translational gap, well, from technology standpoint, the translational gap, it varies a little bit. But of course, I believe that there will be some degree of distance or of this translational gap between humans and animals, just because of the nature of the organism. And when it comes to pathology, let's say, they say that, okay, all the models are wrong, but some of them are useful. And I don't think we will ever get away from this.
I guess that makes sense. It's part of the gig, I suppose. So how is the current rate of technology development supporting these projected improvements, specifically for brain imaging?
Well, if for many years, for more than 20 years, 1.4 Tesla was a standard magnetic strength of magnetic field in the clinics, the transition to 3 Tesla took a really long time. I believe the approval for clinical use was given in 2002 or something. Then the transition from 3 Tesla to 7 Tesla in humans was already much faster, and it's spreading really, really nicely nowadays. I think permission was given around 4 or 5 years ago, and now, at least for research applications, that's go-to field. And if we look into what is standard nowadays in the preclinical world, in animal research, of course, 7 Tesla is like the lowest field that is nowadays used, and 9, 11, 14, or even higher fields are being utilized.
Is there any actual danger to humans that they have found from using a more powerful magnet in MRI scanners?
Well, that is an ongoing research. So, of course, it was meticulously studied that, let's say, moving from 1.5 Tesla to 3 Tesla is not inducing any problems, or there are no confounding factors, or at least long-term factors that can be observed in humans. And the same goes for 7 Tesla. But of course, when we are talking really high fields and moving beyond 7 Tesla, it's still being studied. There are biological effects that people feel immediately being in the scanner, like peripheral nerve stimulation and these kind of things. So it's an open question.
So based on those limitations and the current rate of technology development, do you think that the SFN's projection of, you know, in 20 years, high resolution imaging being widely accessible is accurate?
It might be. I mean, 20 years is really far away in the future, and seeing how the developments are being accelerated now, it's really hard to predict the exact timings of this. Already now, with 7 Tesla in humans, we can talk in sub-millimeter resolution in structural imaging. And when we push it higher, of course, the resolution gets better. Plus, there is a huge advancement on the side of imaging sequences, if we are talking MRI. So, of course, there is more that we can do with even existing scanners. So it's really hard to define what is the highest possible resolution there. It's already on the level, like theoretically possible to do the imaging on the histological level in vivo.
Based on what could be possible in the future, is there any part of the brain or any specific scientific question that you would be really excited to see solved by higher resolution images?
Oh, I don't think we can find anything new in terms of structuring the brain, just looking from the purely anatomical perspective. This is the main advantage of magnetic resonance imaging, that we can really have this high contrast in the soft tissues and do it in vivo. But of course, the functional mechanisms, how everything works together, what is the exact mechanism of, let's say, neurovascular coupling, how the metabolism goes, the oxygen utilization, and all of these questions, there is still decades of research ahead. And the higher the resolution or other features or characteristics of our tools, the faster, the better it will go. Plus, if we touch on the combination of technologies, it's not only about the resolution, but also what and how we can see and on what level. If already now, at least in animals, let's say invasive or non-invasive electrophysiology, optogenetics, deep brain stimulation, those are almost routinely combined nowadays with imaging readouts. We can also see that there are new things coming to the market, the biosensors, the fiber photometry, all of these things that push the limits, both in resolution, sensitivity, and also looking into the other sides of the biology. So not only structural images, but also what it means from, let's say, activity perspective.
That's excellent. Thank you so much for joining us. We really appreciate your insight into this topic.
Thank you, Mary. Thanks for having me.